sharp macro photos. How do you get them? According to me, there are four factors that you need to know about and to master to get the sharpest possible results. And in this video, I'm gonna go through those four factors, what you need to know, and how to optimize each of them to get the sharpest possible macro photos. I'm gonna begin by talking about the most obvious and easy factors, and I'm gonna go into the more advanced ones that can prove very important to understand. Yeah, let's go. Factor number one is focus. Obviously, you're gonna need to focus in the right place to get a sharp result. You need to focus on your subject, right? And this can be pretty hard in macro photography. Obviously, if you have a static subject that is in the same place all the time and doesn't move, then it's not that hard. You can just use a tripod and set that up and then carefully focus, and then you're done. Or even use autofocus. It gets trickier though when you are photographing something that moves, or that something that sits on something that moves, for example insects sitting on a leaf out in the wild. That is the kind of subject that I usually photograph, and then you need to use some other techniques to set the focus in the right place. First of all, I personally don't like autofocus for macro photography. Some people use it and say that it works well for them, but I find it easier to have full control and to use manual focus. And what I do is I usually use a manual focus lens like this one. And then I look at what I'm gonna photograph. If it is an insect that is about as big as the sensor, I begin by setting the focus ring to 1:1 magnification, because I know the subject is about as big as my sensor and I want to cover it, to get it to cover the frame. Then I know I need to be somewhere around here. And then I don't touch the focusing ring that much after that. I instead focus by moving the camera in relation to the subject. So if I'm gonna photograph my fingertip here, I clasp my elbows against my body, try to use both hands, but that's not possible now because I'm photographing my finger, but normally. And then I rock slowly back and forth until it is in perfect focus, and then I take the photo. And that's the technique I use most of the time, and I think it works very well on live insects. And to really see where the focus point is, I think the best method is, if you're using a mirrorless camera, to use focus magnification so that you kind of zoom in the middle of the image, so you can see if that is sharp or not, so you can push the shutter at the right moment. But then obviously the most important thing is to just check afterwards that you got a sharp photo, so you can take more if you need to. You also need to know that even if you have practiced a lot like I have done macro photography for years, you still will get a lot of photos out of focus. It's just hard to focus properly when you are at that kind of magnification. So you need to understand that maybe 9 out of 10 images will not be focused in the right place, but that's okay. Just take a lot of photos and keep the ones that are focused in the right place. Factor number two is movement. And what I mean by this is movement between the subject and the camera in relation to each other. Obviously, you want to avoid movement. You want the subject and the camera to be still in relation to each other. Otherwise, you get motion blur, which is not good for sharpness. Again, if you use a tripod and if the subject is static, this is pretty easy, right? You just set up the tripod and then you adjust the focus and you take the photo and you will not have any motion blur at all. But if you're out in the field photographing insects that are alive and that move fast, this can be a bit harder. There are a few tricks. One trick that I like to use is the insect usually sits on something, for example a leaf. Then I like to hold that leaf with one hand, and then I put the lens on the hand to support it, and then I
adjust the distance to get the focus right, and then I take the photo. So that way there is minimal movement between the subject and my lens. Also, if like the insect sits on a leaf, I sometimes just pluck the leaf if that's possible. Sometimes the insect will then fly away, but that's life. But many times it will still sit there on the leaf, and then you can use this technique to kind of support the lens like this. And yeah, you have to find small tricks like that to minimize the movement between the subject and the camera. Also worth mentioning is that a lot of beginners tend to focus on buying macro lenses that have image stabilization because they think that will help them. I also thought this when I was a beginner. But as I have tested in another video, I've linked that in the description, image stabilization doesn't actually help at all when it comes to getting sharp photos. It helps a little when it comes to framing the photo, it gets a bit less shaky, but when you take the photo, it will not make that much of a difference. So don't focus that much on image stabilization when you're looking for a camera or a lens for macro photography. I have found that it doesn't make that much of a difference at all. But then also, as we will touch upon in the next factor, if you use a flash, it is not that important to minimize this movement. Then you can usually get away with having a lot of movement between the subject and the camera. So let's move on to the next factor. So factor number three to get sharp macro photos is exposure time. And I'm deliberately not using the word shutter speed here, and I will explain why. So to get a sharp photo, obviously you want to have as fast exposure time as possible, right? You want to use a fast shutter speed. And if you're not using a flash, my recommendation is to always be at least 1/200th of a second. That is, I think, the minimum to get sharp macro photos if you are at one time magnification or more. Preferably use 1/250th or even faster if it is possible. That will get sharper photos. But it can sometimes be very hard to have fast shutter speeds when you're doing macro photography because there is not that much light that comes in at high magnifications. So usually you would have to set your ISO very high, and you don't want to do that, right? Because you want to have the least amount of noise possible. So what I recommend if you're doing high magnification macro photography of insects, for example, is to always use a flash. That way you can use a small aperture and you still will have enough light. And the nice thing with using a flash is that if you use a normal, like, battery driven on camera flash, it will be very fast unless you're at maximum power. So if you're at like 1/16th or something like that, that I usually am, the flash will be very fast, like 1/10,000th of a second. And then it doesn't actually matter that much what kind of shutter speed you use. And the reason for that is that the flash will be so much stronger than the light around, for example, the light that comes from the sun, so that it will completely overpower that. And then if you use a slow shutter speed, like 1/60th of a second, for example, the moment when the flash flashes at 1/10,000th of a second would stand for maybe 90-95% of the light in your scene, and then the sunlight will like cover the rest of the exposure. So what I'm trying to say here is that it is kind of equivalent as having a shutter speed of 1/10,000th of a second, because most of the light that lights your scene will come from that fast flash anyway. So that way you can use slow shutter speeds. And that also tells you that it is not important to use high speed synchronization. A lot of people ask me about HSS, high speed synchronization, if they need that. But no, you don't need that. You can just use a slower shutter speed, like 1/200th of a second or 1/100th of a second, and combine that with a fast flash, and you will have a fast exposure, and that will make your photo very sharp. So let's move on to the last factor, which is maybe the most complicated one, but very important to understand. And that is depth of field. Obviously, if you focus in the right place and have minimal movement between the subject and the camera, and also have a fast shutter speed or a fast exposure, then you will get a very sharp photo where you focus. But a problem in macro photography is that the depth of field is very, very thin. It's just how lenses work. The closer you focus, the shorter the depth of field. And with a macro lens, you focus very closely, especially if you have, for example, a Lauva lens that goes to 2x magnification or more, then the depth of field will be super thin. But as we all know, the way to increase the depth of field in photography is to have a smaller aperture. So why don't we all just set the aperture to like f22 or something? That would be the optimal thing to do, right? Unfortunately not, because another thing that happens when you focus really closely is that the diffraction increases a lot the closer you get. So for example, if you're doing like landscape photography on a full frame camera, a rule of thumb is that at like f11 you can take a sharp photo without too much diffraction. Diffraction is a physical phenomena when you have a small aperture that makes light bend in a certain way that causes the image to become blurry. And the smaller aperture you use, the more diffraction you have. So at a normal like landscape or portrait photography, the rule of thumb for full frame cameras is like f11. You shouldn't have a smaller aperture than that, because then you will get diffraction and a less sharp image. But in macro photography, this rule is modified a bit. So the closer you focus, the smaller range of aperture you can actually use without getting into diffraction. So my rule of thumb is, if I'm at 2x magnification, I never have a larger aperture than f8. If I'm at 3x magnification, I never have a larger aperture than 5.6. And if I'm at 4x or more, I try to be at f4. There is a table for this, or there are lots of tables out there. I will link one in the description here, where you can look this up to see where you need to be at in terms of aperture, not to get diffraction problems. It obviously depends on the resolution of your sensor and how close together the pixels are and so on. But this is something you need to know about. You can't just shoot at f22 in macro photography and think you're gonna get a sharp photo, because you will not at high magnifications. And this is the reason focus stacking is so popular in macro photography. So focus stacking is simply when you combine a lot of photos with a very short depth of field into one photo in a computer software. And then you get one photo with a deeper depth of field. And this is actually the only way to get photos at high magnification that have deep depth of field. It is physically impossible to do it with just one shot, because you have a lot of diffraction at high magnifications, which make the photo soft. So you have to shoot at a large aperture like f2.8 or f4 or f5.6, and then you get extremely shallow depth of field. So you have to take sometimes hundreds of photos at different focus points and then combine them together later to get deep depth of field. And that's focus stacking. And as I said, if you're at like 3 or 4x magnification, f5.6 could even give you a lot of diffraction and like a softer image. And that is the reason I think that sometimes people focus too much on having like a 4 or 5x magnification macro lens, because many times you will actually get just as good and sharp a result if you use a 2x magnification and then crop in on your small subject. So I hope this wasn't too unclear. You need to know that diffraction kicks in a lot at high magnifications, and you should look at those tables and or even just use my rule of thumb. And also you should know that there is a formula that the effective aperture increases a lot when you're focusing closely, and it is determined by the magnification and your nominal aperture. So if you have, say you are at f8 in aperture and you're at 1x magnification, then your effective aperture is actually f16. And if you are at f8 at 2x magnification, then your effective aperture is f24. So that's kind of how it goes. And you, if you would take a normal photo at f24 at like a landscape, you would have a lot of diffraction, right? And that is what you get in macro photography if you're at high magnification and use small apertures. And don't ask me why it is like this. It's just like laws of physics, and I haven't read up on the details, or I don't even know if people know why this happens, but this is just how it is and you need to know about it. Okay guys, that was my tips about getting sharp macro photos. Did I miss something? Please comment below if I didn't cover everything there is to understand. These are the things that I try to think about at least when doing macro photography to get the sharpest possible photos. If you like this video, I suggest you subscribe to my channel. I post new videos about macro photography every week. And please leave a like on the video if you did like it. It helps my channel and I become happy. And yeah, that's it for this video. See you soon again. Over and out. Bye bye.